if you raise that, let me first. Yeah, okay.
Actually, there's going to be an opportunity for everyone to talk and ask questions afterwards. So from 1:30, there will be an opportunity to talk and ask questions from 1:30 downstairs. And that would be a great time saver. So let's begin this.
Thank you. Okay. Thank you very much. Well, actually, I think all you know, all the presenters were really informative and remarkable. And I just would like to maybe ask a few questions which might initiate the discussion. Because the point where we, most of the country representative, I mean, ambassadors and country representative mentioned in related to trade and investment relationships. And just to ask, because some of the success stories are really remarkable, but I would like to maybe ask the panelists, maybe if they can give us some of maybe comparative advantage, which might really make the country attract Japanese investors. Because in Africa, we have most of the countries have their own good profile, but which makes it best for one country might be really good, attractive for Japanese investors. So, maybe if you can give us some few examples, and then after that we can continue our discussion. Thank you. Please, start with it. It's okay.
Thank you very much. So, Djibouti is. Has one singularity. It's we are hosting Japanese self-defense forces, and we believe on people-to-people diplomacy. Diplomacy also became economic, so we are trying really to get visibility. A few years ago, when I came to Japan, Japanese people used to ask me, "What is Djibouti?" But of course, it's a country. A few after time being was, where is Djibouti? Because Japanese self-defense forces were there, so Japanese embassy have been opened there, and we had also JICA and some other also actors. And finally, now they say, yes, we know. Like, yes, we can. So they come. They can come as a visitor, as a tourist, as a businessman. And also we believe that, I'd like to thank the organizer for pointing this issue as trade, but not aid. I am the Vice Dean of African Diplomatic Corps in Tokyo. We are 38 embassy. And what we are trying to do is to build a bridge with Gaimusho, Foreign Affairs, with the Minister of Economy, with the JIBIC, with JICA, JETRO. Through them, we are trying to act collectively on the frame of TICAD, and more we have a contact with the private sector, and to emphasize that Africa is no more, it's not a problem, it is an opportunity. So now in Djibouti, if I can talk about Djibouti specifically, we are waiting a lot of investor. After a few weeks, I plan to go to Djibouti with 35 private company because we are organizing 110th anniversary of Djibouti Chamber of Commerce. And of course, we would like to have people from Kobe also. You're welcome. You can be academic, or you can be private sector, and it will be about economic integration. I think it's very important that Japan also be present, and that's why myself am going there with them. And I'd like to see this opportunity to invite all Kobe people, I think, to Djibouti. Thank you.
Good.
In case of Ethiopia, I think the first thing is the geographical proximity to the Middle East, Europe, and the rest of Africa make Ethiopia is more advantage. And the second one, yes, I want to mention is the population itself is a resource for Ethiopia. Ethiopia is number two after Nigeria in the population-wise. So by the increasing the number of the middle class, there is a big domestic market, not only just for export. A domestic market in Ethiopia is very huge, and now we are seeing within very few years that Ethiopia domestic market is very crucial. So that is number two. Another thing which is good for Japanese to come to Ethiopia is we have a 20 years average of age. Out of 100 million people, most of them are young. And it's very easy to be trained because of the system of government education in Ethiopia. We established 1,500 technical and vocational schools. And we have more than 40 public universities, apart of the private one. So we have a lot of number of students who can be trained easily so that yes, you can use them for manufacturing, for industry, whatever. So we have three most crucial things that make Ethiopia is more advantageous for Japanese to come in. And apart from the weather condition of Ethiopia, very favorable. We don't need AC in most of part of Ethiopia. You don't need a cooler or heater because the weather itself is very very humble. So please come in your.
Thank you very much. For us as Botswana, you know we are located at the epicenter of Southern Africa. So you are looking at a population of more than 250 million. If you invest in Botswana, you are investing, you are sure of the market of the region. So you are not just looking at Botswana. And we are equidistant from most ports for handling of your goods and your services. Secondly, we are a very safe country. I know a lot of Japanese here are looking at investing at places where they are assured of their personal safety, of the safety of their resources and of the safety of their investment. We believe in the sanctity of products, of contracts, and we respect contracts. We believe in the rule of law. Thirdly, if you look at the Global Competitiveness Report, Botswana ranks among the top four globally competitive countries in Africa. So you are short of a manpower which is non-militant, which is willing and able to work and to produce goods for you and to have to help you in your investment. And then lastly, we are the least corrupt country in Africa. If you look, you can Google right now, the least corrupt country in Africa is called Botswana. So you are assured of the rule of law, of strong institutions, and of the ethical way of doing business. But we are also a country willing to work and partner with Japanese companies that want to invest in Africa through construction, through energy, through power plants, through building roads, through building railways. We are an admirable country in Africa that is also willing to move from where it is to improve the living standards of its people. We have what we call the youngest population also. So we have a dividend, what people call the geographic dividend. We have a dividend which is trained and educated to reap rewards from. So if you invest in our country, you will find an able population and a labor force that is willing to work in a harmonious and safe atmosphere. Thank you.
Okay, Zimbabwe, thank you. Thank you so very much. In Zimbabwe, in terms of comparative advantage with Japan, I would mention first the abundant mineral resources. I mentioned about platinum, Zimbabwe being home in Zimbabwe soils. It's home to the second largest platinum reserves in the world, known as South Africa. And platinum has many wide uses. If you see any motor vehicle, get it out of the ground, because well, if that resource remains under trouble, it's not useful to remain alive. So what we are seeking is partnership with Japan, bringing the expertise, bringing the technology for win-win outcomes. And the environment is there. Incentives, generous incentives that are given to investors, you know, like in Morocco, the free importation of raw materials, 100% repatriation of profits, and the like. And in agriculture, we've got lots of fertile land. I mentioned we're almost the same total land surface area with Japan, but unlike Japan, where 80% is not inhabitable or agriculturally useful because of the volcanic activities around here, Zimbabwe, 80% is flat land, fertile land, which can be used for agriculture. And maybe I can talk of organic farming, you know, health, living, wellness. Organic farming is the future. And Japan, of course, in that area, they can also bring in expertise so that we produce an output which meets Japanese tests and Japanese standards in terms of quality of the product that we make. That's why we're seeking cooperation. And the people, the highest interest rates in Africa is about, and peace and stability, of course. I can go on and on, but those are the key.
To agree with my colleagues, I think the most important thing is the freedoms. A country which provides the freedoms, I think, would attract investment. Sometimes what we notice that sometimes maybe with the change of government, schools and what, people tend to lose their investments and what. In our country, most of the investors are given investment protection, and at most, government has not interfered into private sector investment. There are also existence of institutions, as other countries have mentioned, and also the rule of law and effective and applicable incentives. For example, in Malawi, what I would say is that I mentioned earlier that the problems which Japan is facing, they are the opposite for Malawi. Like I mentioned, for example, problems of age, of aging society, which is making it very difficult for people to have their people to get employed. You find that in our countries in Africa, we've got a lot of young people, whereby they put most of the Japanese companies would outsource their way to Africa. At the same time, you find that Japan has got a lot of excesses, whereby in Africa, some of those excesses are a dream or a luxury. So countries such as Malawi do provide an opportunity for you to come and invest. For example, since my presentation was at the last time, and also because of the sense of time, our country currently has got the biggest quantity of rare earth in the world, whereby we've noted that recently most countries such as Belgium, UK, and Luxembourg and other countries have said that by the year 2025 to 2050, they are going to ban the usage of commercial vehicles. We've got mines in Malawi. Actually, what has happened now is that a lot of people have been coming and calling to take their positions in the country, because very soon it's going to be the next big thing about rare earth.
Well, thank you very much for those wonderful comments. And we're going to have some final comments from our moderator.
Thank you very much. Before I just make a short conclusion, we really like to apologize for technical problems with devices and everything. And also, we really thank you for being patient with us, running around here and then making sure that we are trying to give you the information which is really important for everyone. And afterward, the discussion is not finished, or we'll be able to get time to discuss with ambassadors and diplomats from African different countries. But before that, I just would like to say also something about COVID, because our city government is working on really very hard to expand our cooperation, because right now we are working with Rwanda, and we are hoping also that these diplomats and ambassadors to continue our communication further, and then probably we'll be able to expand our cooperation with other African countries, because Kobe City would like to be a gateway for Japan in doing business, economic exchange and investment trade relations with Africa. So I'm Africa COVID liaison officer. So any communication you have, you can just send me, or if you have any question, then we can discuss later. So with that, I would like to thank everyone, and maybe please thank for our panelists really with a round of applause. Thank you.
Well, I'd like to wrap up this first session, this session for this morning, by just again saying thank you very much, and just reiterating that you know there's trade and globalization. Kofi Annan had once said that going against globalization was kind of like going against gravity. It's going to happen, and it's going to happen, and as it happens, there are more and more opportunities. Again, for many of the young people in here, where you will see a lot of opportunities opening are these countries that have been kind enough to come and talk to us. And you can see that they're talking about rule of law, they're talking about corruption. And a lot of this stuff is, those that are here and talking about it, they're the ones that are really progressing. But I think the entire continent is really starting to progress. And it's something that we can all really look forward to. And one of the things that it seems a little bit counterintuitive is the city of Kobe. The city of Kobe is now coming, and they're connecting with a landlocked country in the middle of Africa. Why would they do anything with Kigali? And yet, when you go to Kigali, and I was in the mayor's office in Kigali in March, and Mr. Soma, who's not here now, there were about seven of us, all from Kobe, in Kigali. When you go to the Japanese embassy, there are people from, and everybody knows that Kobe is very, very active. And it's the only Japanese city that I know of that does this. So it's quite an interesting dynamic, but it's also very progressive. And what we do is we transfer our knowledge, we transfer our skill set, we transfer a lot to them, but we also get a lot back. And it goes in academia, in business, and in just people to people. And it's up to us, it's up to the local, at the local level, and at the individual level, to start making connections. So I would encourage everybody to visit all of the countries that have been up here. I have to tell you that I haven't been to many of them yet. I go to Africa every year, but I'm looking to expand, so I'm looking forward to the discussions this afternoon. Please remember, be this building, second floor, at about 1:30. You can have a chance to ask questions, question time at that time. I believe that everybody will be available for chatting with some of the students and some of the staff and some of the faculty. Lunch is going to be outside. There's Indian lunch, there's Persian lunch around for those of you who are interested. So please do that. There's also a full schedule. We have about 80 presentations today. 80 presentations, there's poster presentations and all kinds of presentations. So that, Mireille, do you want to talk about it? So I'm going to break now, and Mireille's going to talk, but I'd like to do one more round of applause to our panel. Thank you very much.
これより B5館 2階 の B207 から B217 の各教室で教員や学生などによるプレゼンテーションを実施いたします。学生は B213 教室にてポスターセッションを数多く準備しておりますので、ぜひお越しください。また1時15分から B5館 2階の